My topic is to be or not to be. To be or not to be. This is an eternal question. But in this eternity, it sounds different every time. This is a question with endless philosophical debate behind it. In fact, these questions was answered by all religions and various philosophical doctrines. To be or not to be. This is well known which character this phrase belongs to. But it seems to us that it has long outgrown this framework and sounds much broader, more universal, and it refers to a full, almost complete analog of the sense of life, the meaning of life, human's purpose and self-realization. If you know what to be is, then you know what an ideal is. You know where to go, what to compare with what. And you can understand if you have managed to achieve this ideal or not. If in the past humanity life, people were divided into strata, castes, such as aristocrats, peasants, men, women, for whom this to be was different. And it seems to us that in the last 20th century, there was a huge change in this understanding, namely a huge increase in the number of people who think more or less in one direction. Development, emancipation, education, and accomplishment in your profession. They say the two most powerful words in English are the shortest, I am. Whatever you put after these two words determines your destiny. To the general question, who are you? We usually answer a name and a profession. I'm a teacher, I'm a diplomat, I'm a director, I'm a professor, and only then can we go deeper into ourselves and give other indications of our identity, religion, nationality, gender role, etc. But the first response, as a rule, is associated with professional affiliation. How did this understanding come about? A starting point for this understanding can be ideas dating back to the Renaissance, when Giovanni Pico della Mirandola, 15th century, declares, man is a product of his own efforts, or man, create yourself. Thus, a starting point for your life and a vector for your actions was set, as well as a responsible person was appointed, me. Then, the era of industrialization left an imprint on this. And of course, Protestant ethic, where work is important. And you can show by your professional achievements that you are a member of the elect. Moreover, the same 20th century was marked by the gender equality and the emancipation of women. A significant proportion of women are now also involved in workplace jobs. That means that to be for a woman nowadays, no longer to be a mother, to be a wife, but the same professional self-actualization, the same path through education, the same criteria of self-evaluation and evaluation by society. In addition, there has been a long period in the history of mankind without a global war, in which a huge part of male population could realize themselves. Consequently, all men who would in the past be involved in the military nowadays find themselves in a profession. And finally, the same 20th century, almost all the world's population was involved in education. Now everyone understands. Through education, you can achieve your highest. Straight and clear path. school, university, work, career. Based on this understanding, a model of the future is being built. And the social institution of upbringing and education are also being built on this understanding. That's why the main purpose of this institution, not only to transfer knowledge, but mostly to transfer a set of competences which will allow you to choose the best job and build a career. And there is a justice and equality in it. The fact is that people can build such a universal ideal regardless of their initial data, race, origin, geography, country. People build their career by increasing their professional value, by acquiring some skills and competences. Thus, they are promoted, society appreciates this. You succeed and become a professor, a teacher, a diplomat, and so on. And this is such a blissful confidence in it. After all, this confidence is so life-affirming, optimistic, fair. You grow, you get recognition, you know in which direction to move. It depends on you. You get recognition in your professional achievement. And this is the content of the concept of being. And this content is absolutely clear and universal. By the end of the 20th century, at the beginning of the 21st century, it becomes clear to everyone, to people in all countries, both developed and developing, and on all continents. That is why people move to the big cities, leaving their wilderness. Of course, there is a material stimulus, but it's a trivial component. The male stimulus that they want development, emancipation, equality and rights and opportunities, education, because this is a direct path to a future work and consequently to career and consequently to your self-realization, which was and still understood through professional accomplishment. But suddenly it's all wrong. Suddenly, everywhere, we are attacked by digital civilization. In the era of digital transition, such an understanding of being through professional self-realization is already being called into question. Doubts are associated with, first of all, with the enormously rapid pace of change. The fact is that over the past few decades, there has been an explosive growth of change caused by the disruptive development of digital technologies. The rate of scientific and technological progress can be characterized by the social anthropic metric, which expressing the ratio of the average time between two consecutive revolutionary achievements in technology to average life expectancy. The result is summarized in this graph. And for clarity, there is a picture. Thus, using this social anthropic metric, a distinction can be made between two stages in the history of scientific and technological progress, and as a result, is the history of mankind. We can see that in the pre-digital era, doesn't work anyway, radical changes in the technological environment and the changes that they caused in the life of society stretched at least for several generations. However, in the era of digital transition, the pace of technical modernization increased so much that radical social technological changes began to occur several times within one human life. As a result, we have arrived at a sharp narrowing of planning horizon of social and technological development. In the past history of humankind, scientific forecast was carried out by the methods of interpolating those trends that we already knowing in the present. Malthus, Marx, Club of Rome. Historical experience showed that these methods failed even in the slow past when it came to the long-term forecast. In the era of the digital transition, making scientific forecast using these only known methods, it's obviously already incorrect. For in the medium term, and it's highly doubtful, even in the short-term forecast, 5 to 10 years. Thus, we have a deficit of vision of the scientific future. Second, the undefined role of human in the context of unexpected, it's such a rapid development of AI. An open question is alarming. In history, the liberation of mankind from heavy, harmful physical labor was considered as a noble mission of scientific and technological progress. The smart machine today is invading all workplace roles. The area in which a person surpasses machine decreases at each moment in time. At the same time, the machine today takes away from a person an easy and desirable work in which a person finds motivation, self-realization, life structuring, socialization, and in general, pleasure. The machine today invades even the area of highly intellectual work. That is, scientific and technological progress encroaches on the most sacred mind and the intellect, that which defines human being. Hence, the third point follows. Uncrowning the idea that the human race is at the top of the universe, that we are superior than anything on the earth, in the sense that we and only we are thinking being. Uncrowning human being as an intellectual, as something higher and very important, changes the significance of our goals, the significance of achieving these goals. The crucial question is, should we devote our life to becoming an outstanding chess player and yet still play worse than a machine? And this applies to everything. In this uncertainty, there is a lot of questions for everyone and for everything. For young generation, what to do now in order to be tomorrow? What do I need to study now? What competences should I obtain? Where should I direct my life energy? For parents, what to teach, how to advise, and what meanings to invest in children? But the tradition, parents, the education system, invest in children and understanding based on the experience in the slow past, which doesn't work anymore. For politicians, what to promise people? For example, should they promise jobs? Or should they explain that in the nearest future, there is a high probability of complete shortage of jobs for people? And of course, there are a lot of questions for education system. At the same time, when it's absolutely unclear what to teach, we are told we need to learn faster and constantly relearn. Slogan, teaching to learn, already sounds like a kind of banality, behind which, however, there is a lack of competence, lack of ideas about how to restruct education, about methods which will be adequate to the challenges of the time, both in terms of the content and especially in terms of the pace of changes. It turns out that there are guides along this path. Parents, the education system in the broadest sense, the state, politicians, and all of them show us the way, suggesting what needs to be done today in order to be tomorrow. It turns out that there is the blind leads the blind. So there is a state of complete uncertainty without understanding of what we need to study, what we should prepare for. Nothing but questions. It is like a road is being removed from the structure. The situation can be viewed as an existential crisis. And this crisis can cover humanity on the global scope. The space of meaning and goals has been occupied by emptiness. Aristotle once said, "Nature hates vacuum." The big question is, what will this emptiness be occupied with? The emptiness which is connected with the lack of understanding of what being is. I mean, we have to take initiative. Otherwise, if we do not proactively respond to new challenges, then in this uncertainty, there may be various undesirable response. There are, for example, various sects, ISIS, etc. There are various organizations that are looking for hesitant and confused. They will feel this emptiness perfectly. In this content, special attention should be paid to the urgent need to strengthen the role of corporate social responsibility. This is necessary because not only we have here the problem with an extremely blurred picture of the technological future given by the pace of transformation. More significant, there are questions which lie in the humanitarian plane about the purpose of human, about what is good, happiness, about the responsibility of society for the results of scientific and technological development. Of course, this is the eternal question, but they have made the transition to the digital civilization. At the same time, their understanding requires energy corresponding to the pace of development of the digital world. The future itself depends whether the answer will follow in time, that is, immediately. And what this answer will be? The answers that in the spirit of Norbert Wiener's philosophy should not be determined by only a spontaneous play of technical and economic forces, but also should be developed on the basis of the principles of humanism and the aspirations of the spirit of human being for millennia. Thus, the time is ripe. It corresponds to a new moment in the history of mankind. And as a result, it should be on the agenda, at the forefront of research in the field of ethics, politics, social philosophy, and in fact, of all social institutions. That is why we consider it necessary to strengthen the ethics of corporate social responsibility, the ethics which regulates the relationship between human being and a machine, and under any conditions determines the primacy of the dignity of the social role of mankind. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this contribution. My question is maybe connected to the contribution from Dr. Pribán, because there was something about communities, authentic communities against society. I think that I can sense from your talk the call for such authenticity of human presence, of the so social being. And I think that this is in contradiction to the technological evolution and to stay against it. So is it really in the core of humanity to stay authentic in the face of the protruding evolution of AI and so on?
I hope no one can predict the future. It was the main idea of probably my presentation. But I am looking for the future with optimism, and I hope we will find our identity. But I wanted to say that nowadays, for almost for every one of us, it's very important, probably crucial, to show your professional affiliation, your professional achievements. And everyone is struggling in this direction, strive to achieve these landmarks. But when we don't have these landmarks, it's understandable what to do. Where can we find these landmarks to compare who are we, to find ourselves?
Thank you.
Okay, we got one more question over there.
Do you think it's possible for people to live in uncertainty in regard to your digital transformation? People might not have any landmark and such. So do you think it's such a big problem? Can't people adapt to that situation?
I guess nowadays we even didn't recognize that we live in such an uncertainty, because I see there are two options. Either person sees that there are uncertainty and there is no possibility to predict even the nearest future. And this is a problem, because even you understand this is no possibility to predict the future. It's a problem for yourself. But another option is people think nothing will change, nothing is changes. We can predict the future. But this is also there is also a problem, because this is an illusion. And I guess why I spoke about social responsibility, especially corporate social responsibility, because it's necessary to probably to raise this problem, to show people that there is uncertainty, especially for young people, because they still go to the university not only to receive knowledge, but mostly for to receive diploma and to go to choose the best job. If they knew in advance that something would be changed, probably that they would choose another way, be a musician and something else. But I agree with you that fundamental science is the best one. But it's still a big question for people. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. One last more, if there is a hand to be risen. If not, I actually wanted to ask you a question, because you mentioned that today to be is very much linked to the professional side of things. And
people here.
Yeah,
look at yourself.
Yeah, I know. I completely.
Look at these beautiful, wonderful girls and ladies.
I'm completely with you. But you also said that this view is sort of slipping out of our hands now. That it's moving away.
It could be no one.
Yeah, and there's this sense of emptiness. But then I was surprised that you stressed the corporate social responsibility. Do you think we should sort of keep the old model of to be as a sort of director, as a philosopher, and so on, or is there some other way out of the emptiness, or is there anything other on the horizon? And of course, you being from the St. Petersburg, I'm just thinking about, you know, Dostoevsky was talking about emptiness all the way back in the 19th century. So, is there some alternative out there?
(Clears throat) I don't know exactly is the alternative or not, because nowadays we cannot see another landmarks, but only professional achievements. If you can ask all of these people here, how would you find yourself if you have no your professional achievements? Who are you then? Who are you? What would you answer? If you are paid by government, okay, machines, they will work for you and give you money to live, to stay alive. And who are you? I'm living for this money from government. I'm no one. I don't know. You have to find. But why I speak about corporate social responsibility, because it seems that people try to hidden this problem. For example, my society, philosophy, they prefer to speak about Greek philosophy, about ways, about some pictures, but not about this very crucial point. This is why I think it's necessary to speak about that. Thank you.
And many thanks for speaking about that. So please, once again, Professor Shestakova.
Thank you very much.